If you like my content and you find it entertaining and informative, and you wish to buy me a coffee for it, please consider supporting me on Patreon. Link in the description below. Do we know what sort of entry requirements were in place in the Roman army? Let's check the sources together. Salvete nobiles mei ex optati revenitis ad canale meum hic metatromos allocor, hodie de exercitu romano loquemur. The life of a Roman soldier was no easy task. Training, marching, fighting, wearing armor, building, the life of a Roman soldier was tough. But how hard was it to become part of the Roman armed forces? Vegetius, Polybius and Marius got you covered. Generally speaking, to train a successful Roman soldier, four things needed to be achieved. Recruits have to be skillfully selected. This criteria will vary, I'll get back to this point. Soldiers need to learn to care for their arms and armor. They must be brought to a high point of physical robustness by daily exercise. They must be taught every possible situation that can arise in battle and how to meet it. They must learn to obey orders. Polybius, a Greek historian of the Hellenistic period, tells us how the selection of the levy in the Roman army was conducted. The selection of soldiers in the levy in the early Roman army is described by Polybius. Every citizen gave his name and came to the place of levy. The tribunes of the four legions to be enrolled took seats in four booths. And before people actually start devouring me in the comments for having written four this way, I'm aware that most people think in Roman numerals are used to the subtractive way, but this was used mostly in elegant spelling and mostly in the Christian Middle Ages. And there is overwhelming evidence that the Romans normally used the additive instead.
Roma in vita.
The word tribune indicates various possible offices in ancient Rome, the two most important of which are the tribuni plebis and the tribuni militum. The military tribunes were responsible for many administrative and logistic duties, and could lead a section of a legion under a consul or command an entire legion on their own on the battlefield. The men of a tribe who had been called for service were grouped into fours, the four men of each group being as nearly equal as possible in all points of fitness. The first group of four was then presented to the tribunes of the first legion, who had first choice from the group. The tribunes of the second legion took their choice from the remaining three. Those of the third legion took their choice of the remaining two, and the fourth man of the group was assigned to the fourth legion. The next group of four from the tribe was similarly presented to the tribunes of the second, third and fourth legions in order, and the remaining man was assigned to the first legion. From the next group of four, the first choice was given to the tribunes of the third legion, the second to those of the fourth legion, the third choice to the tribunes of the first legion, and the remaining man was assigned to the second legion. This process continued until all the men to be enrolled from a tribe had been distributed to the four legions, giving to each legion groups of equal average excellence. Citizens of age who did not give their names for the draft would be considered deserters and be sold into slavery. Initially, Roman soldiers were enrolled from Rome, and then they would serve into a military campaign, and after that they would return to their civilian life. So this draft system worked very well for that. And besides, serving in the legion was a normal incident of life for a youth of that time, and so they would prepare for that, both with their education and their sports. But then came the Marian reform of 107 BC, by the statesman Gaius Marius. Among other things, these reforms introduced the concept of continuous service in the army, with recruits being selected from many provinces within the Republic and receiving a pay. That's when principles for the guidance of enlistment became more officially organized. Marius introduced a minimum height for service of 5 feet 10 inches in Roman measure, which would be about 5 feet 8 inches in modern terms. Clearly, when the demand for soldiers were greater than the supply, or in times of emergency, this bare minimum was not insisted upon. Vegetius, Roman writer, tells us that height was in fact a less important quality. In his own words, "Let therefore the youth who is to be chosen for martial tasks have observant eyes, hold his head up, have a broad chest, muscular shoulders, strong arms, long fingers, not too extended a waist measure, lean hams and calves, and feet not distended with superfluous flesh, but hard and knotted with muscles. Whenever you find these marks in the recruit, do not be troubled about his height. It is more useful for soldiers to be strong and brave than big." Although it would occasionally happen that a whole new legion would be raised, Usually new recruits will be divided into several already established legions, as to never have a full legion made of inexperienced people. The new recruits would follow the lead of experienced soldiers and quickly become optimal themselves. The Roman historian and politician Sallustus tells us that the youth was enlisted as soon as he could stand the physical strain of war. Moreover, Vegetius tells us, no one does not know that, with the coming of puberty, men were compelled to submit to the levy, for nothing is so quickly or thoroughly acquired as those things whose study is begun from boyhood. From Livy and Gellius we learn that youth were required to give in their names upon reaching the age of 17. As Roman dominion expanded and legionaries started joining the army from many different provinces, a question arose in the academic world of the Eternal City. What type of boy would be better suited to serve in the army? City boys or countryside boys? Vegetius answers as follows. On this point, I think it has never been open to doubt that the youth of the country is better adapted to arms, for it is reared under the open sky and occupied in labour. It is trained to endure the sun and to spurn the shade. It knows nothing of baths nor of delicacies. It is simple-hearted and satisfied with little. Its limbs are hardened to endure all kinds of toil, and it has grown accustomed in the country to handling implements of iron, to digging ditches and carrying loads. After enlistment, Republican legions and Imperial professional legions had a different way to conduct business. In the early Republic, once a legion had been assembled, it would be immediately sent to make contact with the enemy. In imperial times, recruits would need to be trained, pass three tests to prove their speed, ability with weapons, and military confidence. After this probation period, the full military training would begin. A soldier was expected to be able to endure a march both at ordinary and military pace. To give you perspective, a Roman ordinary pace was 20 Roman miles in 5 summer hours, which is about 18 modern miles. A military pace was 24 Roman miles in 5 summer hours, which is about 22 modern miles, which, if you ask me, is a frigging run. Since they were expected to be able to do all of that in full gear, they were also required to carry a 70-pound pack on their training march to make it more realistic. Picture that! Roman soldiers must have been extremely fit. I mean, it makes you want to hit the gym and get your cardio game up. Roman soldiers were also expected to be able to build structures, roads, plant a stake securely, and dig a trench. They were famous for entrenching quickly. Roman soldiers were able to build a whole camp while in combat, which is rather remarkable. Now, when discussing training for the Roman soldiers and the army, there is a massive, ginormous elephant in the room that needs to be addressed, and that is something that Vegetius tells us. In other words, the idea that Roman legionaries were training with shields and swords that were twice the weight as their regular ones used in combat. Now, clearly, we need to remember that Vegetius is a 4th century Roman writer that is speaking about a time past, and even though he still is a great source, we can't just take anything he says and consider it to be true, or most importantly, as widespread as the Roman army did this. Perhaps some officers did it, but that doesn't mean that it was done throughout the entirety of the Roman period by all legions everywhere. It is possible that some legionaries were told to train that way, but it is also important to consider that modern science and modern studies are now showing that most likely it isn't in fact a great idea to do so. That is because even though by practicing with a heavier implement, said soldier will eventually be stronger, that will come with a loss of precision and hand-eye coordination. The reason is that the muscles used for a shield and sword that have twice the weight of a regular sword and shield would be different because of a difference in balance and heft, which would be different enough as to engage separate muscle groups, and therefore when returning to the normally weighted weapon, even though a little bit of a placebo effect will make us feel that we are now more explosive and quicker, the body will need to recalibrate when swinging with a lighter implement. In other words, it is possible that swings now could become less accurate because the body is adjusting to the difference every single time. Now, of course, having soldiers become stronger and stronger is desirable, but perhaps that should be achieved with regular muscle training exercises such as push-ups or even weights, anything that would not confuse muscle memory. Alright, noble ones, well, I hope that you enjoyed this video. If you did, please remember thumbs up, and if you're not yet members of this community, become a noble one, subscribe to my channel for more content from the Metatron. Having considered and having seen all the different requirements to become a Roman soldier, would you have passed such exam? I think that for myself, I might have some problems, particularly on the physicality, as I'm a little bit of a skinny guy. But let me know what you think about your own current condition. Could you be, right now, in this very moment, accepted into the Exercitu Romano? Well, let me know in the comments below. And remember, the Metatron has spread his wings. Goodbye.